Hello, this video is going to talk about magnetic fields designed for the VCE Physics Unit 3. So firstly, talk about permanent magnetic fields and permanent magnets. Here, some iron filings have been placed on a variety of magnets, and the iron filings, being magnetic, line up in the shape of the magnetic field. Magnetic field lines point in the direction that a compass would point. So if you put some compasses around here, they would point round from north to south. The arrowhead of a compass is a little north pole. It points towards south magnetic poles because opposite poles attract. Now that means that these lines have a field, and a field direction is the direction that a compass would point. And so a compass placed between the north and south pole would point from north to south, and the field lines therefore follow this direction. If you had two north poles, then the field lines would point away from both north poles, and so you'd end up with a shape of field like this. Now you may have done this experiment if you take a magnet and suspend it from a thread. It will rotate until the end, the little north pole, points towards north. So a suspended magnet points towards north. If you did this experiment on the Earth near the equator, it would align itself this way up. But if you remember that opposite poles attract, that means, of course, that underneath the north pole of the Earth is a south-seeking pole of a magnet. We are use the word seeking because this north pole, if left suspended, will seek out north. But opposite poles attract, so the field lines here in the direction that a compass or a north pole would point towards geographic north, which is of course a south-seeking pole. So a little compass needle is a little north pole of a magnet, and the reverse, the back end, is a south pole of a magnet. Just to remind you, a north pole of a magnet points close to geographic north, it seeks north, and it points in the direction that a compass would point. In fact, a compass is a little north pole, and the arrowhead of a compass is a little north pole, and that means that under the north pole of the Earth is a south-seeking magnetic pole. Now these poles move around over time, and they're not really a permanent magnet, they're caused by the core, the iron core of the Earth, and some currents inside the core. Now permanent magnets are caused by magnetic domains, and the domains can be either random or lined up. And those magnetic domains which you align, in hard magnetic materials the domains stay permanently aligned, so that would be like a permanent magnet. But in soft magnetic materials like this iron core, the domains will move back to random positions when you turn off the current. And so this can be an electromagnet, whereas a hard magnetic material could be turned into a permanent magnet. You can induce magnetism in objects, so if you put these paper clips, they will stick to either of the two poles. And they stick here because you induce a little south pole at the top and a little north pole at the bottom. In fact, you induce, may cause the domains in there to align all the way along the paper clip. And so if you were to cut the paper clip in the middle, let's say, you would have a south pole at the top and a north pole, followed by another south pole and a north pole. Think back to the diagram with the magnetic domains. And the domains line up in the paperclip to make it become magnetic. If you have a current carrying a wire, then that current has a magnetic field associated around it, and the magnetic field is circular. The right-hand grip rule shows you the relationship between current and field. If you take your right hand, the fingers wrap around the thumb. When you view it from above, you will see the fingers wrap round in an anti-clockwise direction when the thumb shows the current coming towards you. That shows the relationship between magnetic field and current. If you wrap a current round in a circle, then that field applies all the way around the circle, and it means the field goes always through the centre of the coil in the same direction. If you stretch that circle out and make a number of loops, you make a solenoid. And a solenoid is an electromagnet. And you can use the right-hand grip rule to determine, if you know the current direction, you can work out that the magnetic field goes through the centre of this coil. It's worth thinking, you know that the current, a solenoid has a magnetic field that looks like a bar magnet's field, like this, and loops around the edge. But in the middle, you can't get to the middle of a bar magnet, but you can get to the middle of a solenoid, where we have a strong uniform field. Uniform means all the field lines in straight lines and evenly spaced. Now, the right-hand rule can work the other way round. The fingers can represent the direction of current flowing around the solenoid, and the thumb represents the direction of magnetic field. Now, remembering magnetic fields point from north to south around the outside of a magnet, that makes this pole, this end of the solenoid, a north pole. So that's just representing the rule being used in reverse, with the fingers representing the current and the thumb representing the field in the middle, i.e. pointing to the north pole. It's a quick example. We've got a plus and a minus here. These two coils are identical, carrying current in the same direction, and it's going across the top. So using your right-hand rule, if the current goes across the top of those coils, that means that the magnetic field will point to this end, making this end the north pole. And if this is the north pole, field lines point away from it, makes this a south and this a north pole. So these two coils would attract each other and the field lines would go from north to south. Now we'll talk about the motor effect. The motor effect, when a current passes at right angles to a straight magnetic field, a force is produced at right angles to both of those. If you consider the field between a north and south slab magnets, which is a uniform field, and the circular field around a current-carrying wire, here we've got an X represent a current into the page. When you combine those two fields, the top lines add up and form a circular bit, but the bottom bits are in opposite directions and so cancel. And you end up with this shape of field called a catapult field. Now the catapult field, you can almost see this wire being pushed downwards. In fact, the field lines tend to straighten and that produces a force. Now that force would be down here, which is at right angles to the field north to south and the current into the page. You can summarise that rule with a right-hand rule, the right-hand slap rule, where the fingers show the B field, or the magnetic field, i.e. north to south. The thumb is the current direction, that's into the page. And then your palm points in the direction of force. So try that with your right hand, pointing your fingers from left to right across the screen and your thumb pointing into the page, and then the palm will push downwards. Try that now. You can also use the left-hand rule, which is essentially the same rule, the same relationship of directions, just uses your first finger for the magnetic field, your second finger for the current, and your thumb for the force. Now, those have a mathematical relationship. The force is B times I times L, sometimes times sine theta, where F is the force, B is the magnetic field strength in Tesla, and this defines the strength of magnetic field, I is the current in amps, and L is the length in meters, and theta is the angle between B and I. Now here, the angle between B, the magnetic field north to south, and I, the current, is 90 degrees. And so sine of theta, sine of 90 degrees, is 1. So this is not necessary when they're at right angles. But if they aren't at right angles and there's an angle between them, then sine of that angle will give you the proportion of the force. It can also be shown that the F is equal to BQV, where Q is the charge on a particle, a given moving charge, and V is the velocity of that charge. An example, so here we've got a field between these magnets of 500 millitesla. There's 2 amps in the wire, 90 degrees to the field, and the wire in the field is 20 centimetres long. What's the force on the wire, and which direction does it act? So F equals BIL sine theta gives 500 millitesla, so 500 times 10 to the minus 3 tesla, multiplied by 2 amps, multiplied by 0.2 metres, gives 0.2 newtons. If you use either the left or the right-hand rule, you will see that the force should be, with the field north to south and the current going up, should be in towards the page. So the direction is into the page. Here we've got a positive charge of 9 nanocoulombs moving at 70 degrees to the magnetic field of 1 tesla. It's moving at 200 meters per second. What's the force on the charge? And which direction is the force? So here we will use BQV sine theta, which is B of 1 tesla, the charge of 9 nano, so that's 9 times 10 to the minus 9 coulombs, multiplied by the velocity of 200 meters per second, multiplied by sine of 70 degrees, gives a force of 1.7 times 10 to the minus 6 newtons. And the direction still into the page. The motor effect can be used to turn a motor. The current is going from plus to minus, so around this loop, and back down this side. And if you apply the field from north to south and the current coming out along this way, that means this wire is pushed. If the current going in this direction up this wire, this current wire is pushed down and the other side is pushed up. And so the motor spins. And then the commutator over here means that as it goes over half a turn, the commutator connects to the same side of the coil, and so the current is still coming back along this wire and up along this wire. So it's going round in a loop. And after half a turn, it's still going round in a loop the same way, and so the coil keeps spinning. If you want a bigger force, you would increase the magnetic field or the current or more turns. In fact, if you double the number of turns, then you double the force. So we could put a value of N in our equation for F equals BIL multiplied by N for the number of turns. And here's a drawing showing that field shape with two catapult fields together, showing this coil rotating or turning. And a loudspeaker just uses a coil, and it has a magnet on the outside between north and south, and the same arrangement on this side. And so as the current goes through one direction in here, this, depending on the direction of the current, the speaker is either pushed out or pulled in. And because on the other side you'd have a south pole and a north pole, the current is going in the other direction and the field's in the other direction, so this side is also pushed in the same way. If you supply an alternating current to the coil, it will be pushed out and then pushed in again, and it would vibrate with the same frequency as the sound. As the sound will have the same frequency as the alternating current that's being supplied. So to summarise, there's a coil in the field, and there's an alternating current, therefore an alternating force, and the frequency of sound is the same as the frequency of the alternating current. So a higher pitched sound comes from a higher frequency alternating current. Hope that's helped. Thanks.